How do you make a planning that accounts for uncertainty?
The first step is as usual. We make a product breakdown structure, the PBS, and a work breakdown structure, the WBS. Then we make a planning based on both of these, including any dependencies there may be. The resulting planning is called the deterministic planning. The deterministic planning uses normal estimates for time and effort. Also, resource availability is taken into account. Based on the deterministic planning, we start identifying risks together with the stakeholders and experts. Each of these is then coupled to one or more steps in the planning. For each of these risks, the probability or chance and the impact are determined. This is called the growth risk. The impact is described not only in terms of time, money, and resources, but also in terms of consequences for public opinion and in terms of compliance, legal and regulatory affairs. Each risk is assigned an owner who is responsible for the risk. This can be the project executive, the project manager, or any other of the stakeholders of the project. For each risk, one or more countermeasures is defined, and these are added to the deterministic planning as additional work to be done, with appropriate time, budget, and resources, of course. Then the probability and impact after taking these countermeasures is reassessed. This results in the net risk. With the deterministic planning, the identified risks, and the countermeasures as input, a Monte Carlo analysis is carried out. This Monte Carlo analysis is done using regular project planning software. This results in a series of so-called probabilistic plannings. The series starts with a deadline with, for example, 50% probability and continues with a deadline with 95% probability and finally one with 99% probability.
When do you choose between P50 and P99?
Depending on the risk appetite of the project executive and the specific organization, one of these percentages is chosen for communication to stakeholders. Typically, the more pressure there is on the project to be on time, the higher the chosen percentage. A very common pitfall in practice is to use a lower probability trying to make a certain external deadline. Of course, the risk assessment is not only done once, but regularly during the project. In large, critical projects, this can be as often as a couple of hours every 2 weeks. In less critical projects or less professional organizations, one can use a simpler method for estimating the deadline. This can be done using a stochastic method with 3 data points: the best scenario, the worst scenario, and the most likely scenario. These values are used in a PERT estimate, which is essentially a weighted average, resulting in a planning that takes the uncertainty into account. In practice, the best scenario and most likely scenario are estimated very close to each other.
How does this work out in practice?
First of all, in most traditional business projects, the additional effort of including probabilistics in the estimates is deemed too much work and too complex in relation to the impact of not being in time. In hindsight, this is not always true and may very well be one of the reasons that large IT projects don't deliver on time. In some organizations, the failure rate of projects is so high that more generic measures are taken to deal with disasters. For example, one of such a measure is a department with people that are specifically assigned to manually perform normally automated tasks. Another example is a dedicated call center for customer support after a problematic product launch. One very common example is the assignment of troubleshooters in times of crisis. These troubleshooters have the privilege of circumventing normal operating procedures and making executive level decisions. After they reached the desired result, the collateral damage has to be cleaned up. And that is, of course, before normal operations can resume.
What would you recommend your colleague project managers?
From my personal experience, I always make sure I have a fallback scenario, a plan B. It's common knowledge amongst project managers that if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. I always add that I have a plan how to fail. And when that disaster happens, even if you carefully planned everything, don't panic. Be clear to your stakeholders and project members, and be honest about what you can and cannot do, and about the uncertainties. One final piece of advice to all project managers out there: Hurry when you've got time enough. That will make your life a whole lot easier when your time has run out.